Because most of my life, I had believed I was a Buddhist. Because I grew up in that ambiance. And then when I was 15, 16, I read a book called Siddhartha by Hermann Hesse. I don't know if you've read it, but you should if you can. It's really good. And after reading that book, I really questioned myself. And I said, am I really Buddhist? How can I be a Buddhist if I don't quite understand yet the Buddhist philosophy and what Buddhism really is? So then I started to realize that maybe actually I was still learning to be a Buddhist. So therefore I was like in the process of becoming a Buddhist. And I believe I still am today. I'm 27. It's been already 10 years and I'm still in the process of becoming a Buddhist. So it's not something that just happens from one day to another, you know. Being a Buddhist is not about just reading books or going to courses, taking meditation or, you know, initiations. It's also about the lifestyle, you know, the attitude you have, the way you think, the way you act, the way you talk. So that's basically, you know, one of the important parts of being a Buddhist, you know. So for me, it's been like that. And I think it may be helpful if I can share a little bit my small thoughts with all of you. Because I understand it can be hard sometimes to understand the traditional way. Of course, the tradition is super important because it's something that has come from many, many generations, thousands of years, people practicing and having realizations and understanding and passing it on to the next generations. So that's why tradition is super important. It's there and it's available. It doesn't mean it will work for everybody. Each person has to find their own way of understanding and what works for them. You know, because nobody can really come and say, okay, I found the truth, take it. And it may be his truth, but it doesn't necessarily mean it's your truth. You have to find your own truth. Somebody can come and help you to find that. And that's what Dharma is for. The gurus also. The guru, the teacher, is helping you to find your own way, your own self. Investigating inside and understanding the nature of the mind. That is the guru and the dharma. But ultimately the real guru is inside ourselves. We are our own guru, we are by ourselves, you know. So it's up to us to walk the path, always. We are born by ourselves in this body and we will die by ourselves. There will be nobody who will take care of us afterwards, in the sense like holding our hands and carrying us, you know, we have to walk the path by ourselves. It's like you're in the forest at night and it's completely dark. So you're trying to get out of the forest, but you don't know which direction to take. And then suddenly the full moon comes out, and then the full moon helps you to see a little bit better. So then you can see better and you can maybe climb a tree and see which direction you want to take. So then basically we're trying to get out of the forest. We're not going to the moon. The moon helps us to get out of the forest. So that's a little bit like the metaphor I like to use with Dharma and gurus. You know. Many people think the guru is salvation. No, the guru will help you to understand our own nature. But that's not salvation. Salvation is in ourselves. And the further away we search from ourselves, the further away we are from ourselves, and the harder it is to find that. So I just wanted to make a point there, you know, before I started, because I have struggled with that for a long time. So I think, and also it's just my point of view, you know, so it doesn't mean it's the truth or anything, you know, you just take what you feel works for you, what you like, and what you don't think works for you, just leave it, you know, it's not that important for you. Each person is different, right? Like for example, when you're walking on the beach and you see the ocean, the sea, and the sun is coming down, and you see the reflection of the sun coming towards you. It's like a path, right, from the sun to you. And what you see shining is what you see shining, but somebody else who's over on the other side will see their own shining, right, their own path. Actually, the whole ocean is shining, so we only see one small part, which is from the sun to us. And what we are seeing that's shining, the other person can't see, because they're in another place. So we have to walk to where they are to see the same sure you have seen that before. And sometimes when you go in the plane, you can see the whole ocean shining, which is how it normally is. So that's just like a metaphor to understand that each of us is different as individuals. Each grain of sand in the ocean is different. So you can never really compare, and you can't really judge other than judge yourself, because we are the only ones who really know ourselves, and we really know where we are or what we are doing. So that's why it's important to try not to judge. And if you have to judge, then at least don't condemn, right? Because we can all change. So the November course is about Buddhism, and I wanted to start talking about samsara. Many of you know probably already what samsara is. According to Buddhism, samsara is like the wheel. It's a wheel where we are born and we die again, and we are stuck in this wheel of constant rebirth and, you know, just going around and around. So Dharma is here to help us to be liberated from that, even though that's very far away still. We have to concentrate on the now, right? So it's important to, that's the concept of samsara. So the purpose of Dharma is to help oneself in order to help other people. And that way we find our own purpose. But basically, if you think about it, the animals on this planet, their purpose is to survive, to reproduce. And we are like animals also. The only difference is that we have many different capacities. We are able to think, we are able to speak, and so many. Each of you know already. We're all human beings. So, apart from, of course, surviving and reproducing, we have many other purposes. And of course, the main purpose is to help ourselves, to understand ourselves, so that we can help other people do the same. So, in this world, you know, sometimes it can be really hard for some people, and we have the opportunity to be in contact with the Dharma, which can help us a lot. There are many other different ways of finding our own true nature and understanding it. And one of them is Dharma. So we are all here, and that's a good thing. It's a really good thing. So if some of you sometimes feel it's difficult to understand, don't worry. You know, it's easy. Ultimately, it's easy. Even though these things, because of tradition, may become complicated, but that's up to you to filter what works for you. Because for each person is different. So, like, because Gyatso was talking, Venerable Gyatso was speaking about karma yesterday. And so one of the important things of karma is the intention behind it. The intention is so important, you know, because that's the main thing that is behind our actions and our thoughts and speech. So that's why it's really important to always check oneself. Before you check someone else, check on yourself. Because many times we tend to just judge other people and not really look at ourselves. Oh, this person is doing that, he's saying this, blah, blah, blah. But then we don't really look at ourselves. And then we forget about what we are doing. So it doesn't really make sense, right? So that's why it's so important to check oneself and see really what our intention is. Because based on our intention, then the karma comes from there. If the intention is positive, then the karma is positive. If the intention is negative, then the karma will be negative. I mean, I can't really show you that karma exists. I didn't believe in reincarnation for a long time, and karma was one of the things that I didn't believe in. I used to call myself agnostic scientific, and then I added spiritual afterwards. I was never an atheist, because you never know what really is out there, you know? You know what your own world is from your eyes, what you live, but there's so much out there. You know, when you go to another city, and you see everybody just moving around, you're like, wow, this exists all the time. You know, it's just that I'm here right now, and I'm seeing it now. But even if I'm not here, it's still happening, you know? So what we think is not everything that is, you know? What we see is not everything. It's part, it's a small part. So that's why you always have to be open also, not like close doors and say, no, that's not true. That doesn't exist. This is maybe will exist. You never know. And yeah, so for a long time, I didn't believe in karma. And then slowly, slowly, I started to understand that karma is a little bit like the law of the universe. You know, it's like physics is a type of law. So the karma is another law. It's so subtle. It's very hard to see it. But from generations and generations, people have experienced it. And that's what we have today. It's the teachings of the Buddha that have been carried on to many generations. So if you don't believe it, you can check. But it makes sense and it's very logical. You know, because karma is like the law of cause and effect. You know, what you give, you will receive eventually. And even if you don't believe it, I think it's pretty logical. You know, because sometimes you question yourselves, why are these people suffering? You know, they didn't do anything. So there must be a reason why. Yeah. And for me, I think it's the most understandable explanation to that. So behind our intentions and our choices, which are very important, of course, because every day we make choices, our emotions sometimes they guide us towards those choices. One of the things I think Dharma tries to help us is to not become slaves to our emotions. Because there are many different emotions. There's the negative ones and the positive ones. The negative ones, for example, anger or jealousy or like different very negative emotions, sometimes create like more negative energy. Like for example, anger. When you get angry, you go blind a little bit. And then from that, then you can do some actions which later on will cause a lot of suffering to yourself and to other people. Because you were blind at that moment, you became a slave to that emotion. So you have to really be careful with some emotions, because when you do become a slave, that creates an energy and a reaction. You know? So it's always better if you have emotions, to have positive emotions. Try to control the negative emotions. It doesn't mean that those emotions are not going to be part of us. You know, like for example, anger. I can be an angry person, right? Even if I don't look like it right now. But sometimes when it comes out, then it comes out. Yeah. It doesn't mean I'm not angry. Like I'm not an angry person. It's inside. This has to be a catalyst that will make it come out. So it's not like we can banish anger, you know? But we can, or maybe you can, I don't know. Eventually I think Dharma can help you with that. But I think mainly it's to try to control that emotion and try to be aware of where it's coming from. Like when you start getting angry, then you say, oh, this is happening. Then you try to breathe, try to rethink, try to understand where it's coming from, investigate, observe, and then slowly the anger will disappear. And so that's like very good, one of the first steps in order to try to keep the negative emotions at bay. Because the emotion, negative emotions are a big thing about karma, you know, they can create a lot of bad karma. So we have to really check that. So, sometimes, you know, the emotions can create an attitude or a state of mind. You know, we have a thought, and from there it becomes an attitude. And because maybe we're stressed, somebody comes and the person is talking to us very nicely, but because we're stressed or we're pissed or whatever, then we talk really bad to them. We don't kind of pay attention, or we just, you know. So that sometimes is something that we really have to be aware of, you know. If you're stressed and it's hard for you not to be angry with the person, then that's the test. That's when you can be the real Buddhist, you know. Then if you can really control that and be a good person at that time, then that's, you're slowly becoming a real Buddhist. Just because you read a book or do some meditation doesn't mean you become a Buddhist. At least from my side. Each person has their own view, of course. So it's so important to be aware of our mind at all times. You know, because if you think about it, everything that's been created by the human being, like starting with the Gompa, our clothes, you know, the floor, the roof, the planes, the buildings, everything, In one beginning, it started with thought. Someone had to think of that before it started, you know, before they started to create that. So just by looking at everything that's been created by the humans, you can already see how powerful the thought is. So just because you're the only one who knows what you're thinking, it doesn't mean that it's okay to think bad things, you know? I mean, it's, of course, it's normal, you know, but sometimes it's good to check why it's coming, where it's coming, and whether it's beneficial for yourself. So for example, if you criticize someone, you're actually harming yourself more than you're harming the other person. You're also harming the other person. So that's one of the things that's important now that we are alive and that we're here to try to be a better person. And that's basically what Dharma is telling us. And through that, we can really find happiness. Because most of us, that's what we're searching for happiness. And also I had a hard time with happiness because it's like so far away. Like enlightenment, to become enlightened, or to help all sentient beings. How can you help all sentient beings? That's like almost impossible. I used to struggle with that every day. How can I be happy? Happiness. Where am I going to find happiness? I mean, it's a state of mind, you know? So those things for me was really, really hard, and I found ways around it. So instead of all sentient beings, it would be some sentient beings, starting with yourself, your family and your friends, which is enough. And like happiness, I also found that not being unhappy is easier than trying to be happy. So that's like the first step. When you try not to be unhappy, then you make the cause for eventually to be happy. So that's, at least for me, it's easier to kind of tackle now when you think about it. So that's why there's always many ways to see it and many ways to get around so that you can understand it for yourself. You know, because each person is different. Right? And it's normal that for some people it may work, for some people it may not work. You know? So, I don't want to take too much time because I know it's, you know, the day is very intense for all of you. And you are also doing the November course, apart from the teachings, meditations, what's it called, writing sessions?
Discussion
groups, and like dream interpretations. I don't know, there's many different things which I really like to be part of. So I don't want to take much of your time. Maybe we can repeat this again another day. So basically we're looking for happiness. So if we try not to be unhappy, then we can create the causes slowly to be happy. And basically how can we be happy is by helping other people to be happy. And that will come back to us. So the more we try to be happy, the less happy we will be. And it works that way. You know, if you try to be try to buy a lot of stuff for yourself, the more stuff you buy, the less happy you will be. Because this stuff will never reach our expectations. And sometimes it will break, so we'll be unhappy. So if we actually search to make someone else happy, then we'll be happy automatically. Just by seeing them, you know, just the appreciation they give us. Just the action. Even if they don't appreciate it, it doesn't matter. We already did the action. So, yeah, so the compassion, what we like is the well-being, right, to live well. Sometimes, for example, when we suffer, the suffering starts like in one moment, let's say, something happens. Like there can be different types of suffering, physical suffering or mental suffering. Sometimes the physical suffering is created by the mental suffering. You know, like sometimes we can become sick because we're depressed all the time. So our body reacts to that. Our thoughts are very powerful. You know, so they really affect us and they affect people around us too. So what we search for the well-being, to be comfortable, you know, to have food when we're hungry, to have a nice bed to sleep, not to be cold. When we're too hot, we have something nice to breathe. So basically, if we're able to help other people with that, then we're helping ourselves. Because ultimately, we are all just functional beings, right? Our function is to live. So if we live in a better way, according to our own moral code, then we'll be better people, and eventually we can really find that happiness. Eventually. You know, so it's not so far away, but there's first steps we have to take. Our purpose is to become enlightened, to be freed from suffering, from samsara, in order to help other people to reach that also. Basically, that's Buddhism. At least from my point of view, that's Buddhism condensed in a sentence.